So, the systemic option in metastatic renal cell carcinoma. So, this is the place where I work, Manipal. Beautiful place. If given an opportunity, please kindly do come and visit us. So, in the next 15 minutes, I will be talking about the agenda of my presentation will be introduction. As Dr. Axel has talked a lot about immunotherapy, I would like to tell briefly for the benefit of the residents what is immunotherapy exactly means. What are the first line treatment in metastatic renal cell carcinoma? What's the right choice? And if time permits, I would like to briefly touch on second line treatment of metastatic renal cell carcinoma. So, one third of the patients diagnosed with renal cell carcinoma presents with the advanced or metastatic disease. More than 20 to 50% of the renal cell carcinoma with localized disease eventually develop metastatic renal cell carcinoma. So, if we talk about the treatment of renal cell carcinoma, it was dismal before 2005. There was only interferon and interleukins. So, but after 2005, the renal cell carcinoma treatment has revolutionized twice. The initial phase of revolution was with the invention of vascular endothelial growth factor inhibitors like sunitinib. And the second wave is, of course, because of the checkpoint inhibitors in renal cell carcinoma. Now, there's a third wave ongoing with the combination of these two strategies where we are combining vascular endothelial growth factors with the checkpoint inhibitors. So why exactly the first line treatment is important? Because only 50% of the patients with metastatic renal cell carcinoma will get second line treatment, and among them only 20% of them will go on and get third line treatment. So definitely selecting the best line of treatment in the first, in upfront is the most important thing. So if you come to the evolution of first line treatment in metastatic renal cell carcinoma, as I already told, till 2005 we had only two options, interferon alpha and interleukin-2. Then came sorafenib, then of course sunitinib, followed by pazopanib, axitinib, then came the first checkpoint inhibitor nivolumab. Now it's an era of combination of immunotherapy with checkpoint inhibitors, like immunotherapy with VEGF inhibitors. Like we are combining now pembrolizumab with axitinib, avelumab with axitinib, and there is also immunotherapy combination like nivolumab and ipilimumab, which I'll be probably discussing a little later in my presentation. So Carmina, as Dr. Axel has already spoken, so what exactly Carmina told? Sunitinib alone was not inferior to nephrectomy, followed by sunitinib in patients with metastatic renal cell carcinoma who were in MSKCC intermediate and poor, intermediate risk or poor risk group. So in patients with intermediate or poor risk group, sunitinib alone is probably a good option compared to nephrectomy followed by sunitinib. Coming to the concept of immunotherapy. So what exactly, I think this is a very important slide in my presentation, the biologic rationale of combined PD-L1 and CTLA-4 blockade. So what exactly happens in T-cell mediated immunities? T-cell mediated immunity happens in two places, lymph node and tumor microenvironment. So in the tumor, the dendritic cells or the antigen presenting cells present the antigens to the T cells, and the T cells will get activated, go into the tumor microenvironment, where they activate more and more T cells. Finally, it will result in tumor kill. But what exactly happened in cancer? So in cancer, there are three inhibitory molecules or the receptors which are produced in excess. Number one, it is CTLA-4, which is there on the T lymphocytes, which will act mainly near the lymph node area. And the other two inhibitory receptors are PD-L1, PD-1 on T cells, PD-L1 and PD-L2 on tumor cells, which actually takes this acts in the tumor microenvironment. So these inhibitory signals are produced in excess, which in turn actually suppresses the T cell mediated response. So if the concept behind immunotherapy is to block these inhibitory signals, that is CTLA-4 and PD-L1 and PD-L2, so which in turn will activate the T cell immunity, and it will result in better tumor kill. So as I told before, now it's an era where we are combining VEGF inhibitors with checkpoint inhibitors. So why exactly we are combining VEGF inhibitors? So VEGF inhibitors may inhibit the dendritic cell maturation, which is an antigen presenting cell, causing immunosuppression. So if we inhibit the VEGF inhibitors, there is more and more activation of dendritic cell maturation, which will ultimately result in increased T-cell mediated immunity. And also VEGF inhibition may reduce the numbers of T regulatory cells and tumor invading myeloid derived suppressor cells. So if we probably inhibit the VEGF, if we inhibit the VEGF, so the immunity will be boosted. And if we combine PD-L1 inhibitors along with VEGF inhibition, so it will empirically result in, as I have shown in the right hand corner, 1 plus 1 will be more than 2. So it will act in synergy, and we get the best result out of this combination. So these are the four first line immunotherapy based combination therapies which are accepted. And in this, the first CheckMate 214 and Keynote 426 had an overall survival benefit, and Javelin and Immotion had a PFS benefit. So I'll come to these trials little later. First, coming to the IMDC risk stratification, which is very important and which all of the trainees should know, because all the trials were based on IMDC risk stratification. So IMDC risk stratification has got 6 components: performance status, time from initial diagnosis to treatment. If it is more than 1 year, it is a poor risk factor. If it's more than 1 year, it's a good risk factor. If it's less than 1 year, it's a poor risk factor. Low hemoglobin level, increased calcium level, increased neutrophil count, and increased platelet count. All these were the main. These were the 6 components in IMDC. And favorable if the patient doesn't have any of these. That is zero. If the patient had zero score, he comes into favorable category. If the patient had 1 to 2, then patient will be in intermediate category. And if it is more than or equal to 3, it comes to poor category. So my first trial, the three trials which I'm going to expand, CheckMate, Immotion. So the first trial, what I'm going to talk to you is the CheckMate 214 trial, where immunotherapy was combined with immunotherapy and the comparison arm was sunitinib. So in these patients, the treatment name locally advanced renal cell carcinoma with a clear cell histology stratified according to IMDC prognosis score 0 versus 1 to 2 versus 3 to 6 nivolumab plus ipilimumab followed by nivolumab continuation therapy compared to sunitinib. So in the CheckMate 214 trial, there was a clear overall survival benefit with nivolumab with the ipilimumab combination compared to sunitinib. But if we dissected that in the favorable risk group, there was no much benefit, overall survival benefit. There was no statistically significant benefit with the immunotherapy combination compared to sunitinib. So if we come to the progression free survival, actually the sunitinib performed better in the favorable risk group compared to the nivolumab and ipilimumab combination. So hence, in a favorable risk group, this combination, that is ipilimumab nivolumab, is not indicated, and it's only indicated in intermediate risk and poor risk group. So the main conclusion of the trial was this trial showed an efficacy and an overall survival benefit of nivolumab plus ipilimumab over sunitinib in the first line treatment of intermediate risk or poor risk advanced renal cell carcinoma. The incidence of grade 3 to 4 adverse effect of ipilimumab and nivolumab combination was less than sunitinib. It was 47% versus 64%. So in terms of toxicity, the checkpoint inhibitor combination scored over sunitinib. So the second trial, which has got approval in the first line setting, is the combination of pembrolizumab plus axitinib versus sunitinib. So the eligibility criteria was almost same. And the stratification was again favorable versus intermediate versus poor risk according to IMDC risk stratification. And the patients in this arm A received pembrolizumab plus axitinib, and arm B received sunitinib. So in this trial, there was a clear cut overall survival and the PFS PFS benefit with the combination of immunotherapy plus VEGF inhibitor, that is pembrolizumab plus axitinib versus sunitinib, and this benefit was across all risk group, that is good risk, intermediate risk, and poor risk group. This combination scored better than sunitinib. So the main results of Keynote 426 trial was Among the patients with previously untreated advanced renal cell carcinoma, the treatment with pembrolizumab plus axitinib resulted in significantly longer overall survival PFS and a significantly higher objective response rates than sunitinib alone. And the benefit, as I told, the benefit was observed across all IMDC groups. But the problem with this combination chemotherapy of a checkpoint inhibitor plus a VEGF inhibitor was the toxicity. The toxicity grade 3 to 4 toxicity was around 67% in the combination arm versus 62% in the sunitinib arm. As I told in the Keynote trial, in the Checkmate trial, the immunotherapy combination had a lesser 3 to 4 grade 3 to 4 adverse event compared to sunitinib alone arm. So that third trial is a Javelin trial. In this, the eligibility criteria was similar, and the patients were randomized to avelumab, which is a PD-L1 inhibitor, plus axitinib, which is a VEGF inhibitor, which was compared to sunitinib. So in this, there was a clear-cut PFS benefit with the avelumab and axitinib group compared to the sunitinib group, but there was no statistically significant overall survival benefit. But for the, if you take the Checkmate and the Keynote trial, that is, these are the main two combinations which we'll be looking into in the first line setting, that is ipilimumab, nivolumab combination, and axitinib and pembrolizumab combination. If you see, both of them are almost same. There was a similar outcome on same comparator arm, and there was early separation of curve in both the trials, but the follow up was little more with the Checkmate 214 compared to the Keynote 426. So, but I feel that both these combination, both these, that is the ipilimumab and nivolumab and axitinib and pembrolizumab, are equal, and probably we need to decide on which combination to choose based on the side effect profile. So coming to the first line treatment consideration for renal cell carcinoma, multiple good systemic therapy options for metastatic renal cell carcinomas are available, with no obvious clear choices in some of the cases. Good risk patients and those with favorable intermediate risk can have survival for many years with or without treatment. So consider, this is what Dr. Axel also wrote, consider debulking nephrectomy and or active surveillance in selected patients, though there is an option of active surveillance in selected patients who have low burden disease and patients are really stable. So when do I consider nivolumab and ipilimumab combination? When the patients are, when the VEGF treatment is contraindicated, say the patient has uncontrolled hypertension, the patient has bleeding manifestations, or the patient has got an unstable heart, probably in those patients I will consider ipilimumab and nivolumab combination. And in those patients who I want to avoid double immunotherapy combination, I would like to go with pembrolizumab and axitinib combination. So this is how the NCC guidelines looks like in the first line treatment of metastatic renal cell carcinoma. In favorable risk group, there is an option of sunitinib, pazopanib, or axitinib plus pembrolizumab. And in the favorable risk group, in the poor and intermediate risk group, there is option of ipilimumab and nivolumab, that is double immune checkpoint inhibitors, axitinib and pembrolizumab, that is VEGF plus immune checkpoint inhibitor, or carboplatin. But please focus on the right hand column, that is in the favorable risk group, there you have to consider an option of active surveillance in those patients who have a really small tumor burden and who are really fit and asymptomatic. So Bhavan, if I have 5 more minutes, I will just briefly touch on second line option. So
sure.
So the sequencing of approached agents in 2000, so the second line option was pretty simple before 2015. So we had only 3 to 4 agents. There was sunitinib, pazopanib, axitinib, and sorafenib. So in patients with TKI failure, we used to go for one more TKI, and if that failed, if that TKI has failed, we would have gone for mTOR followed by a TKI again. And everolimus, if the patient had failed on everolimus, we would have definitely gone for either sunitinib, pazopanib, or axitinib. And if sunitinib fails, we would have gone for pazopanib. And if both these had failed, we would have gone for one more mTOR combination. But the options are plenty now. So we have again immunotherapy coming in second line options. In 2005, nivolumab single agent got approved after first line failure with the VEGF inhibitor. There is also option of immunotherapy with the VEGF inhibitors. In 2019, we have approved indication of pembrolizumab plus axitinib, avelumab plus axitinib in the second line setting also. So we have now plenty of option for second line treatment. We have in either club VEGF inhibitors with TKI, we have mTOR inhibitors, we have checkpoint inhibitor plus checkpoint inhibitor, checkpoint inhibitor plus bevacizumab, checkpoint inhibitors plus TKI or single agent checkpoint inhibitors. So I'll just run through my slides in another 1 minute. So in the post TKI therapy, we have all these therapies which are now approved in second line. We have everolimus, axitinib, carbosunatinib, nivolumab, lenvatinib plus everolimus combination, and the overall response rate has actually, in fact, has gone on increasing. So, these are all the various trials where the various targeted agents and the immunotherapy agents were approved, and now median overall survival, even with the second line treatment, is approaching 2 years. So, in summary, in second line treatment, my approach to a patient who has progressed and who has come to me for second line treatment is, if the patient is already exposed to immunotherapy, I would like to treat the patient with the VEGF inhibitor like axitinib, sunitinib, or carbosunatinib. If the patient has progressed on immunotherapy plus a VEGF inhibitors, then the options are limited. Maybe I'll start the patient on single agent carbosunatinib or a combination of lenvatinib plus everolimus. And there is a small data, I mean, there is a limited data for immunotherapy and immunotherapy combination, that's nivolumab plus ipilimumab combination, but there are some promising results with this combination also. And if the patient has been exposed to VEGF inhibitor alone, which happens in most of the scenario, patient would have come to us after sunitinib or a pazopanib failure, definitely the patient has to be given an option of immunotherapy and I would like to offer the patient single agent nivolumab. So this is how a patient with metastatic renal cell carcinoma is probably approached in the first line and second line setting. Thank you very much.